Hello everyone, welcome to Prelims Warm Up. In this initiative, which has been brought to you by AptiPlus Academy for Civil Services, we are going to discuss some of the important previous year questions which have been asked in UPSC Prelims. As you are aware that the previous year questions, they play a very vital role in having a comprehensive and a holistic preparation, especially when it comes to the prelims examination. So that is why we are going to look at some of the important questions which have been asked in the previous year's prelims examination. So let us start with the first question for today. The first question that we have is, the most important fishing grounds of the world are found in the regions where A. Warm and cold atmospheric currents meet. B. Rivers drain out large amounts of fresh water into the sea. C. Warm and cold oceanic currents meet. And D. Continental shelf is undulating. So the question is asking regarding the most important fishing grounds of the world, and it is basically asking what are the physical conditions which are necessary to be present in an area in order to ensure that that area becomes an important fishing ground. This question was asked in UPSC Prelims 2013. So when it comes to important fishing grounds, there are many such parameters or many such conditions which are necessary for an area to be an important fishing ground. Now, out of the given options that we have, the most important option is C. So out of the given ones, the most important one is C, that is where warm and cold oceanic currents meet. Those areas become very conducive for fishing, or those areas are usually the most important fishing grounds. But at the same time, I would also like to tell you, okay, this is one of the factors. There can be many other factors which ultimately result in an area being an important fishing ground. So one of the factor is, okay, it is usually seen that in those areas where warm and cold oceanic currents will meet, that area will have very good fish stock. But alongside that also, we also get to see areas where upwelling will take place. Areas where upwelling takes place. And what is meant by upwelling? For that, you have to look at oceanography in your physical geography section. That is when the cooler nutrient-rich water, which is present in the lower layers of the seas and the oceans, they come up onto the top layer, or they come up at the top. Then because these waters, the cooler nutrient rich water which comes out from the lower part onto the top layer, which ultimately will result in the surface water becoming nutrient rich once again. So basically, when this nutrient rich water from the lower layers, it comes out to the top, actually it helps to replenish the nutrients which have been lost from the surface layer of the water. So that ultimately is what we get to see in case of areas which experience upwelling. And naturally, wherever we get to see such kind of replenishment of nutrients taking place in the surface water, so those areas will have a greater growth of phytoplanktons, and automatically phytoplanktons will be consumed by zooplankton. So those areas will have more amount of zooplankton growth as well, and zooplanktons are fed upon by fish, so naturally fish growth will also be high. So one thing that you have understood is warm and cold oceanic currents, wherever they meet, will have good fishing. We'll also have good fishing where we'll have upwelling taking place. Apart from all these, we also get to see that wherever the continental shelf is very wide, that will also result in higher amount of fish stock. Okay, because continental shelf area, over there what happens, the depth of water, the sea water is actually very shallow over there. It's at a very shallow depth. Naturally, what happens is that entire area where you have continental shelf, over there we get to see that the entire water which is present above the continental shelf, that is a photic zone. What is meant by photic zone or euphotic zone? Basically, the area of seawater which is lit up by sunlight. So because of a higher area or higher amount of seawater which is lit up by sunlight, automatically more the amount of sunlight, there will be more amount of photosynthesis, hence there will also be more amount of phytoplankton growth. And again, more phytoplankton means more zooplanktons, and more zooplanktons means more fish stock. So again, that is another important factor. An area which will have very wide continental shelf, such areas are usually very good for fishing. So, but out of the given options that we have, the most important option is C. So 1C should be the right answer. And for that reason, you have to remember the various oceanic currents that we have across the world. So you see over here in this particular diagram of the oceanic currents, the warm currents, they have been shown with the help of red color. The cold currents have been shown either with blue or black. So for example, we get to see here. Okay, sometimes we also get to see over here that some of the warm currents have also been shown black. For example, let's say this Peru current. Okay, this Peru current, it is an example of a cold current. Sometimes this Peru current is also referred to as a Humboldt current. We have the Humboldt current over here, and we have this equatorial counter current, which is an example of a warm current. Since these two are meeting near the Peru coast, Peru equator coast, since these two are meeting over here, automatically this area becomes an important fishing ground. Okay, similarly, you'll also get to see over here, there will be some amount of upwelling taking place. So this entire coastal area along Peru, it is an important fishing ground. Similarly, you get to see over here the Newfoundland area, where you have the Gulf Stream, which is a warm current, meeting with the Labrador current, which is a cold current. Naturally, this entire area, the Grand Banks area or the Newfoundland area, this area is a very important fishing ground. Similarly, you see along the Japan coast, okay, along this Japan coast, you will have Owashio, which is an example of a cold current, and Kuroshio, which is an example of a warm current. They will come and meet together, and hence Japan is one of the greatest fishing nations in the world. Okay, similarly, you will have many such other currents. For example, you will also have here, for example, you will have the Brazil current coming from the top, and you will also have a small current which has not been shown over here, but it is also called as a Falkland current, which is a cold current. So you'll have Brazil current, which is a warm current, and you have a small cold current, which is called as a Falkland current, and they will meet near the Argentine coast in an area which is called as Bahia Blanca or the Blanca Bay area. So this Bahia Blanca or Blanca Bay area, which is near Argentina coast, that area is also a very important fishing ground. Okay, so more or less you can understand with the help of ocean currents, it is possible for us to understand areas which are important for fishing. So 1C should be the right answer. Moving on to the second question for the day. The second question is having a paragraph which talks about a particular area of the earth. Let's read out the paragraph first. So the paragraph says, each day is more or less the same. The morning is clear and bright with a sea breeze as the sun climbs high in the sky. Okay, each day is more or less the same. So the hint will lie in this passage itself. Each day is more or less the same. The morning is clear and bright with the sea breeze as the sun climbs high in the sky. Heat mounts up, dark clouds form, and then rain comes with thunder and lightning. But rain is soon over. Which of the following regions is described in the above passage? This was asked in the year 2015. You have the options as A, savanna, B, equatorial region, C, monsoon, and D, Mediterranean region. Now let us read it once again, the passage, and try to understand. The first line says that each day is more or less the same. Each day is more or less the same, which basically implies that there will be very less amount of climatic variation. Okay, the climatic variation, be it temperature, moisture, rainfall, etc., that will not vary too much. It basically implies that the range of temperature will also be very low. Okay, so the temperature also will not vary too much during the day and night, or even during the various seasons. That is why it is saying each day is more or less the same. So from here we get a hint. Second hint, the morning is clear and bright with a sea breeze. अच्छा, इफ सी ब्रीज इज सपोज टू फ्लो इन दैट केस व्हाट शुड हैपन, देयर शुड बी अ लो प्रेशर डेवलप्ड ओवर द लैंड. How will a low pressure develop over land? Only if the temperature is high enough. Then only what will happen is the air above the land will get heated up. It will undergo convection. And as a result of which we will get to see that vertically air will start to rise up over the land, giving rise to a low pressure over the land. And the air which is present over the surrounding seas, that air will be comparatively cold, or you know, it will be having a lower temperature. And hence the air which is present over the sea that will rush towards the land to fill up this low pressure. That is what will result in the sea breeze. Okay. So from here we can understand the temperature has to be sufficiently high. But next line says that as the sun climbs high in the sky, heat mounts up. So it gets further heated up. Dark clouds will form and then rain comes with thunder and lightning. So basically dark cloud formation will take place, thunder and lightning. For thunder and lightning to take place, you need to have a particular type of cloud which is called as cumulonimbus clouds. And cumulonimbus cloud can only be formed if you have very strong updrafts of air. So air has to rise up in a very strong current, very strong updrafts of air need to be there, which will give rise to cumulonimbus cloud, and that will result in thunder, lightning along with rainfall. And we get to see, but rain is soon over. So very intense rainfall. But again, rainfall will be over, but the same cycle will repeat again next day. So which of these have been talked or which of this is being referred to? From all these hints, you can actually come to the conclusion that we are referring to the equatorial region. Okay. So from all this, we can understand we are referring to the equatorial region. Let us check. 2B should be the right answer. Yes, 2B is the right answer. Equatorial region, also referred to as the doldrums. Over here you can see this reddish portion. This entire area is the equatorial region that we have. Basically equator, that is 0 degree, and on either side if you go up to, let's say, 10 degree north and 10 degree south, that entire area is the equatorial region where we have this particular type of climatic condition as has been described in the above passage. So you will have areas, for example, the Amazon basin, for example, the Congo basin, for example, you will have Malaysia, you will have Singapore, all these areas, Southeast Asia, this entire part is Southeast Asia. You will have this entire part of Africa and Amazonian part of, or some parts of Brazil. So these areas are the equatorial regions. Okay, you'll have tropical evergreen rainforest present over here. So equatorial rainforest will be here. Moving on to the next question that we have. This question is from 2011. And the question is asking, westerlies in the southern hemisphere are stronger and persistent than in northern hemisphere. So westerlies, I believe you are aware about westerlies. They are an example of planetary wind. What is meant by planetary wind? Planetary wind basically means those winds which are permanent in nature, plus they will affect a very wide area. They are not local in nature, they will affect a very, very wide and vast region. Almost their effect will be almost all over the globe, you know, all over the earth. Such kind of winds are called as planetary winds. So westerly is a type of planetary wind, and apart from westerlies, we have the trade winds and the polar easterlies, which are the other planetary winds that are there. So westerlies in the southern hemisphere, they are stronger and more persistent than in the northern hemisphere. Why is it so? This was asked in 2011. Let us see that there are two statements which have been given. First statement is saying that it is because the southern hemisphere has less landmass as compared to the northern hemisphere. Southern hemisphere has less landmass as compared to the northern hemisphere. This is the first statement. Second statement is, Coriolis force is higher in the southern hemisphere as compared to the northern hemisphere. Now, one thing that you can understand, and this is something that you should learn the elimination method. What is meant by elimination method is, it is possible that out of the given 100 questions, you might not be aware about all of them. It is even possible that you might not, I mean, despite of, you know, studying very hard, and studying very diligently, you might still not be aware about the answers to, let's say, 85 questions out of 100 questions. It is also possible you might even not be aware about the exact right answer of even 70 of the questions. So under such circumstances, if you mark less than, let's say, 80, in that case, there is a high chance that you might not qualify the prelims. You might not clear the prelims. So what should you do then? So in such scenarios, it is important that you understand this particular method, which is called as elimination method. Elimination method basically says that you don't really need to always know what is right. You don't always need to know the exact right answer. But you should have sufficient knowledge in order to mark out what is definitely not correct. So you are not, you don't really need to know what is correct, but you should have sufficient knowledge or sufficient idea so as to be able to figure out what is definitely not possible or definitely incorrect. Say for example, over here, if you look at Coriolis force being higher in the southern hemisphere as compared to the northern hemisphere, now that is definitely not correct. That does not work out like that. So you are left with only one statement now. And now the thing is, the southern hemisphere, now even it is possible. It is possible that even this statement might be incorrect. But still, this is something that you might have better idea about, because if you just remember the world map in your head, you will know that this statement is actually correct. The southern hemisphere has less landmass as compared to the northern hemisphere. That is actually true. In fact, in the higher latitudes of the southern hemisphere, you will hardly find any landmass. So A should be the right answer. Let's see. 3A is the right answer. Let's look at the map. I have given a map over here. So you can see that this is this line that you have over here. This is the equator. Okay, this line that you have over here, this is the equator. And to the top of the equator, you have the northern hemisphere. That is this one. This entire part is the northern hemisphere. And below the equator, you have the southern hemisphere. Now, if you see, look at, I mean, just with your naked eyes, you can understand that the northern hemisphere will have much higher amount of land area, much higher amount of land surface as compared to the southern hemisphere. You see, hardly any land is there. So that is why what happens is these westerlies and all winds, basically, they will actually flow over the open oceans. And because they flow over the open oceans, there is less amount of obstacle on in their path. Less amount of obstacle means less amount of friction force, and less amount of frictional force means that there is less amount of, I mean, their speed will not reduce. So naturally, the speed will be very, very high. So please remember that the winds, they are very strong in the southern hemisphere, mainly because of the absence of land in the southern hemisphere, more amount of land present in the northern hemisphere. So that is why 3A is the right answer. Moving on to the next question that we have. The next question is with regards to micro irrigation. Let's see. With reference to micro irrigation, and this question was asked in 2011 again. With reference to micro irrigation, which of the following statements is or are correct? Okay. Let's see. First statement, micro irrigation. Fertilizer or nutrient loss can be reduced. With the help of micro irrigation, fertilizer or nutrient loss can be reduced. We'll see that. Next. It is the only means of irrigation in dryland farming. Only means of irrigation in dryland farming. Next, in some areas of farming, receding of groundwater table can be checked by the usage of micro irrigation. That is what is being said. Now you see, first of all, what is meant by micro irrigation? Now, irrigation, you can understand, is basically watering the agricultural fields. When irrigation is done, normally, or at least earlier, how irrigation used to be there is, the farmers who use these primitive methods, for example, if you have seen paddy fields, then you will know. In case of paddy fields, the entire field is actually flooded with water. Such kind of irrigation is what is called as flood irrigation. But flood irrigation is very wasteful in nature. I mean, it results in a lot of wastage. Wastage, for example, most of the water will ultimately get evaporated. So there will be a lot of water loss. A lot of water will be wasted. And similarly, wherever you have flood irrigation taking place in arid areas, if flood irrigation is done in case of arid areas, for example, sometimes you will find that many farmers will try to grow rice in arid areas like Punjab, and they will flood the entire field with water. So that will also result in something which is called as soil salinity. Okay, that will result in something called as soil salinity, where we will get to see salt. It will start to rise from the lower layers of the soil due to capillary action, and ultimately once all the water has dried up, you will get to see that there will be a thin crust of salt present over the soil, and this entire phenomena is what is called as soil salinity. So basically, flood irrigation is actually wasteful because it results in a lot of wastage of water, plus it also results in soil salinity taking place, especially if flood irrigation is carried out in case of dry and arid regions. Okay, so first thing is so the other alternative to flood irrigation, or another, you know, newer method of irrigation which has been devised in order to ensure that there is lesser amount of wastage of water, similarly in order to ensure that soil salinity does not take place, something called as micro irrigation is practiced. What is micro irrigation? Basically, it is a method of irrigation in which we try to minimize the water loss by ensuring that water reaches only the root area, not here and there. Only water is supplied at the roots of the plant, okay, and that water will be taken up by the plant. Now, micro irrigation is very good in terms of less amount of water wastage and all, that is true. But there is also a downside to it, because initially the initial cost of setting up the entire micro irrigation technique, you know, so that is a little bit expensive. That is the only issue. So micro irrigation ka example kya kya hai? For example, you have different type of things. For example, you will have something called as sprinkle irrigation or sprinkler irrigation. You will also have something called as drip irrigation. These are examples of micro irrigation practices. So I would request you to go through these things. What is sprinkle irrigation or sprinkler irrigation, and what is drip irrigation, and what is micro irrigation. Similarly, for example, you will have a country like Israel, which is very, very dry. It practices micro irrigation, and it has brought about huge amount of success in its agricultural sector just by using and recycling all this water. So it's a very good example of a country which, despite of having very less amount of water, with the help of very advanced technique and micro irrigation practices and recycling of water, etc., etc., it has been able to achieve a lot of success in agriculture. Anyway, so now coming back to what we were saying, micro irrigation, how does that help? Number one, fertilizer nutrient loss can be reduced. Definitely, fertilizer or nutrient loss can be reduced. Sometimes what is done is, as I told you, micro irrigation basically implies that water will be supplied directly at the roots of the plant in order to reduce the wastage of water. Sometimes it is also possible that instead of simply supplying water at the roots of the plant, if some water soluble fertilizer is also added to that water, then again fertilizer can be directly supplied to the root only, and that will also result in less amount of fertilizer wastage. Okay, that is also referred to as fertigation. Okay, so yes, first statement is correct. Second statement is the only means of irrigation in dryland farming. Now that is not correct, because even before the entire concept of micro irrigation came about, before that also people were doing agriculture, people were doing irrigation as well, and at that point of time people were not using micro irrigation, they were using the traditional forms of irrigation. So second statement is incorrect. Wherever you will have things like only, none, absolute terms, something like none, nobody, or only, these statements are usually a little bit of, you should look at them very carefully, because usually they are wrong. But again, not always, but you should have a second look at such statements. They are usually incorrect. Anyway, third statement is, in some areas of farming, receding of groundwater table can be checked. Yes, that is also correct. So out of the given statements, we get to see 1 and 3 are correct. So C should be the right answer. Let's see. Yes, 4C is the right answer. And over here, you can see I've given you a picture, a photograph of sprinkle irrigation or sprinkler irrigation taking place. What happens here is that water in the form of droplets ultimately reaches the crops, and that helps to reduce the amount of water wastage. So this is sprinkler irrigation, which is an example of micro irrigation practice. Moving on to the last question for today's session, we have a very simple question. Which one of the following reflects back more sunlight as compared to the other three, which was asked in 2010? So very, very simple question. Which one of the following reflects back more amount of sunlight as compared to the other three? So we have four options: A, sand desert; B, paddy crop land; C, land covered with fresh snow; and D, prairie land. So you have four options and you've been asked, out of these, which will reflect back more amount of sunlight? But before you answer this, it is important that you understand why this question was asked. You see, in your physical geography part, especially in the climatology part, you have a particular term which is very, very important for UPSC, something called as albedo. Now, what is meant by albedo? Albedo basically means the amount or the percentage of the incident solar radiation which is reflected back by a surface is the albedo of the surface. So let's say you have a surface, you will have solar radiation which is reaching that surface, the incident solar radiation, which is also referred to as insolation. Okay, insolation is what? The incoming solar radiation is what is referred to as insolation. So you will have a surface, you will have solar radiation reaching the surface, but what happens is this, okay, once the solar radiation reaches the surface, some amount of it will get absorbed, some amount of it will get reflected back also. Now, the percentage of the incoming solar radiation which gets reflected back from a surface is the albedo of a surface. So let's say 100% is the incoming solar radiation, and out of the 100%, let's say 20% gets reflected back. And then for that particular surface, from where 20% of the incoming solar radiation is getting reflected back, the albedo should be 20%. Now over here, another thing that you should be aware of is when we talk about albedo, the lighter the color of the surface or the shinier the surface, more will be the albedo. I'll repeat, lighter the color of a surface or the shinier the surface, more will be the albedo, which basically means that let's say, for example, in case of summer, during the summer you will feel or you will see that if you wear light colored clothes, let's say white colored clothes or light colored clothes, then you will feel cool. Okay, you will not feel warm. On the other hand, if you wear dark colored clothes, what happens is you will start to sweat, you will feel warm. On the other hand, during the winters, if you wear dark colored clothes, you will actually feel comfortable, otherwise you will feel cold. What happens is this, in case of light colored clothes, they are able to reflect back more amount of the sunlight, and hence they help you to keep cool. On the other hand, if you are wearing dark colored clothes, then it will absorb more amount of the heat which is coming from the incoming solar radiation, and as a result of which your body temperature will rise, you will feel warm, okay, and you will start to sweat. So out of the given options, as you can understand, in wherever we will have fresh snow cover, see, snow is white in color, so automatically it will be able to reflect back more amount of the incoming solar radiation or insolation. So that is why 5C is the right answer. 5C should be the right answer. So an area like this, which is like having this coniferous softwood trees, sometimes also referred to as taiga belt. So such kind of areas where the land will be covered by snow, they will have very high albedo. That is why you will find that when you go to such snow covered areas, you would actually need to protect your eyes from all the reflection of the sunlight from the snow covered areas. Okay, so please remember what is albedo, a very important term when it comes to UPSC, especially prelims. And there are many such previous year questions which have been asked on the conceptual understanding of albedo. We'll deal with those later. So for today, we'll end our session over here. Hope you like the session, and please let us know in the comment section whether you like the session or not. And please like, subscribe to AptiPlus Academy of Civil Services YouTube channel, and we'll come back with a new set of 5 questions. So till then, stay safe and study hard. Thank you. I should fuck her in the best.